Welcome to Mayo Clinic's ECG segment, Making Waves, continuing medical education podcast. Join us for a lively discussion on the latest and greatest in the field of electrocardiography. We'll discuss some of the exciting and innovative work happening at Mayo Clinic and beyond with the most brilliant minds in the space and provide valuable insights that can be directly applied to your practice. Welcome to Mayo Clinic's ECG segment, Making Waves. In this episode, we explore the development of a new artificial intelligence, AI-enhanced ECG algorithm for assessing left ventricular diastolic function. Joining us is a distinguished academic cardiologist whose innovative work in AI and ECG technology is paving the way for advancements in cardiac care. Our discussion today will delve into the importance of assessing diastolic function, the motivation behind creating an AI ECG algorithm for detecting diastolic function, and the potential applications of this model in clinical practice. It is a pleasure for me to introduce today's guest, Dr. Jae Oh. Dr. Oh is a consultant in the Department of Cardiovascular Medicine at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, where he directs the Echocardiography Core Laboratory, the Pericardial Clinic, and co-directs the Integrated Cardiac Imaging. He holds the Distinguished Samsung Professorship in Cardiovascular Diseases and is the founding general director of the Heart Vascular Stroke Institute at Samsung Hospital in Seoul, Korea. Dr. Oh earned his bachelor's degree in biochemistry with honors from the University of Pennsylvania and his medical degree from the Pennsylvania State University. He completed his residency and fellowship in cardiovascular diseases at Mayo Clinic, where he received numerous accolades. Dr. Oh's research focuses on all aspects of echocardiography, including diastolic function, heart failure with related to diastolic dysfunction, valvular heart diseases, pericardial diseases, and the application of AI, ECG, and echocardiography, what we'll be discussing today. He has published well over 500 manuscripts in 4 editions of the Echo Manual, a key textbook for any learner in the field. His contributions have been recognized with numerous awards, including the Lifetime Achievement Award from both the European Society of Cardiology, Myocardial Pericardial Working Group, and the American Society of Echocardiography. In addition to his research, Dr. Oh is deeply committed to education and mentoring, holding full faculty privileges in clinical and translational science at Mayo Clinic Graduate School. He has mentored over 70 physicians worldwide and is a fellow of several organizations, including the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association. Dr. Oh also serves as the president of the Asian Pacific Association of Echocardiography. We're so lucky to have him with us today. Dr. Oh, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much, Anthony, for this opportunity. Thank you.
I've been really excited about, you know, sitting with you, hearing about the work, but even seeing it come to fruition with your team's work in the literature today. And, you know, your primary clinical and academic interest, we all know you as, the echo guy, the guy that is leading the field that we learn so much from. You know, what sparked your interest in applying, you know, outside of the echo, but the AI ECG to assess, you know, echocardiographic features and diastolic function?
Well, I want to thank our leadership, still Dr. Paul Friedman, to ask me a few years ago about this interest in the ECG AI. And then also, as you mentioned, and I'm an echocardiographer with a primary interest in cardiac hemodynamics and the diastolic functions for many years. And you know, as you know, the diastolic function is one of 2 components of a cardiac function. It really tells us about the health of a cardiac function. And it's the sort of the common pathway for all cardiac disorders, whether it's a valvular heart disease or myocardial disease or even pericardial disease. And most common way of assessing the diastolic function is by echocardiography. I've been doing it for many, many years. And, I think echocardiography does a very good job. But at the same time, it takes a special expertise. It has to be available. And also, still with the multiple parameters that we're using, we still have a significant number of patients that the diastolic function or filling pressure assessment are not possible, and it's not a really screening tool. So, ECG, as you know, is available anywhere, is standardized. And we thought that if someone has a diastolic dysfunction with a relaxation change and high filling pressure, there has to be some change in the heart in terms of structure and function and hemodynamics that has to be translated into the electrocardiographic configuration. And that's where we start doing the AI ECG to create this particular model.
I mean, it's certainly sparked many of our interests, and it's amazing to see how the model is doing. We'll get to that shortly. But I mean, can you just explain, and you almost, you know, shared a little bit, what in general is, just for the layman, diastolic function? And, you know, you kind of mentioned why it's important, but, you know, why should, if you could just reemphasize that.
Sure. I mean, you know, the heart has two functions. One is a pumping, and the other one is a stretching as a diastolic function, because we have to stretch enough with a good relaxation of the heart to fill the ventricle to provide the satisfactory pumping function. That's a diastole. And usually, sometimes we forget about that second part of it. And also, the as a disease, any cardiac condition progresses, whether it's a myocardial disease or with a valvular heart disease, or I told you, pericardial disease, all of that, the symptomatic stage or even pre-symptomatic stage, diastolic function becomes abnormal gradually, so that if we can detect the diastolic function or filling pressure, and we are able to identify most of a cardiovascular disorders. And also we have seen many patients, that asymptomatic patients, that they do have a significant diastolic dysfunction, high filling pressure due to other cardiac disease that we don't know about. And I think that if we can identify those patients by detecting high filling pressure and diastolic function, that'll be a fantastic thing to do. So I think the diastole is more of a preparatory stage for pumping function, but that's the really tells us about the health of the cardiac function.
You know, we think of all the echo parameters. You chose one of the hardest to go after. You know,
that's true.
What inspired you to kind of go after this? And did you have any challenges as you were building this out?
I also mention the mentorship of Dr. Liv Hadley. Many years ago, she came to us. She is a pioneer in echocardiography and Doppler echocardiogram. She was the one that who taught us about diastolic function, and then Dr. Tajik here, of course, that also encouraged that diastolic function assessment. But I think that It again takes multiple parameters for us to do. I mean, in a guideline now, using four parameters, and even after using four parameters, we have a lot of indeterminants, sometimes up to 50% at some centers. At the Mayo Clinic, it's about 25 to 30% centers, a percent of the patients we really cannot provide. And those are the patient population that we really need a better assessment. And so I thought that maybe a ECG AI will be another way of getting to those patients and early detection of diastolic dysfunction. Yes.
And so let's get to the research that you've done and the team have done on this. You know, what were some of the key findings that you found from building this algorithm? And I guess to add on to that, we've talked about the clinical importance. So, I mean, you know, how do you envision this being used in practice?
Yeah, sure. Thanks for asking. I mean, you know, for artificial intelligence to work well, we really need to have good data. And the Mayo Clinic is really fantastic. For the last hundreds of years, we have millions of patients with electrocardiogram and echocardiography. So we really defined the diastolic function parameter very well by echocardiogram from our experience. And then we identify, I think from 2001 to 2023, almost 22 years of patients' electrocardiogram, and which was obtained by obtained within echocardiography determination of diastolic function in 2 weeks. So we end up getting almost 300,000 patients electrocardiogram. So then we, you know, I don't, you know, I have to also credit our engineer, Dr. Eunjung Lee, that we share those electrocardiogram, and then I send those lists to the our engineer, and they train using CNN, they train the model, and then we label. I mean, she labeled the entire electrocardiography based on echocardiography determination of diastolic function, and then she validated using the multiple versions of algorithm, and then found the best one, and then we tested it. So it's interesting that I was really impressed because when it came out, out of 300,000 patients, we used 100,000 patients for the testing as a final testing set. And the AUC of AI ECG to determine diastolic function grading from the zero being normal and one to three, three being the worst, was the AUC was ranging from 0.5 to 0.95, 0.85 to 0.95. And also the separating just binary fashion that normal filling pressure from the increased filling pressure, which is very important clinically, that AUC was a 0.91. So we just, I thought it was a very good model that we can use AI ECG. So I think there are multiple clinical implications of that, because the anyone with a cardiac disease, I mean, the short of breath is the most common symptoms we see in our practice. In someone with short of breath, they must have increased filling pressure, either by cardiac catheterization or echocardiography. Now we can use ECG AI to at least screen whether those patients do have the high filling pressure or not. And then after the our AI ECG was done, we actually look at 2,000 patients in the emergency room with a short of breath with the unknown reason. And when ECG AI says it's a high filling pressure, almost 80% of them did have cardiac dyspnea, cardiac cause of short of breath. And AI ECG says negative for high filling pressure, the reason for cardiac dyspnea was less than 10 or 15%. So I think those are just one simple clinical scenario that we can really use. So I think that the HFpEF, heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, is a very common problem, and it's sometimes hard to detect, right? But the major criteria, diagnostic criteria for detecting heart failure with preserved ejection fraction is detecting high filling pressure. So I think that it'll need some prospective study or trial to confirm that. But I think as ECG AI to detect high filling pressure, as we did, created, will have will come out to be very important screening tool for those patient populations.
So many clinical uses, and as you mentioned, even for the negative predictive value in the emergency room of all this, there is so much use. And Dr. O, there's so many, clinical applications we see this, but back to your research, I do want to, talk about this, because we're in the echo lab, there'll be indeterminate or intermediate values. How did you deal with those? Was the AI ECG helpful in those? And then two, do you see any prognostic value in the predictions from, these algorithms?
Yes, actually, that's what we published from our initial model, the prognostic value of AI ECG, in addition to the AI ECG ability to determine the diastolic function grading. And I was really surprised. I'm an echocardiographer, I told you, been for a long time. And then surprisingly, the prognostic value of AI ECG using the normal 1 to 3 diastolic function was almost identical in 100,000 patients, almost identical to that of the diastolic function determined by echocardiography. And also, I told you already that the 20 to 30% of the patients that we are not able to determine diastolic function by echocardiography because it's so complicated. And even those patient population, AI-ECG was a prognosticate very well based on the diastolic function grading we really had there. So I think we'll, again, we need to validate this prospectively, not only the Mayo Clinic, but the other centers in the country and also internationally, hopefully. And then you'll see actually the data going to come out in the Journal of American College of Cardiology that the AI ECG model was more prognostic in patients with a mitral valve regurgitation, a moderate to severe mitral regurgitation, compared to that the severe MR or effective regurgitation orifices and the regurgitation volume, all of that. So I think it really tells you about the underlying myocardial disease in addition to the severity of underlying disease. So I'm just very hopeful and very excited. Thank you very much for asking.
Really, in today's discussion, we explore the innovative work that Dr. Oh and team have been doing with the AI ECG algorithm for assessing left ventricular diastolic function. Dr. Oh provided insights into the importance of assessing diastolic function, the motivation and the team's motivation behind creating an algorithm of such, and the potential clinical applications of this model. Dr. Oh, thank you for joining us today, sharing your expertise and your unique perspective in this field. Your contributions are not only advancing the medical community's knowledge, but really benefiting patient care. And hopefully we could get this and deploy this to other centers across the U.S. and the world so that they could take advantage of your work. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. Thanks, Anthony.
Thank you for joining us today. We invite you to share your thoughts and suggestions about the podcast at cveducation.mayo.edu. Be sure to subscribe to a Mayo Clinic Cardiovascular CME podcast on your favorite platform. And tune in every other week to explore today's most pressing electrocardiography topics with your colleagues at Mayo Clinic.
This has been a Mayo Clinic podcast.